I know about the religion of Islam, the fact that we had a book called the Quran and that we don't eat pork. This is the only thing I know. He said, well, why don't you come to the masjid? And when I went to the mosque, I was just paying attention to the Muslims inside the mosque. And this is why it's very important as Muslims, we're supposed to have the best character, especially living in the land of the non-Muslims. So when I was looking at these Muslims, I just wanted to see how they react to each other. And they was very kind to each other. They was nice to each other. And I remember they gave me literature, and one of the books they gave me was the English translation of the Holy Quran. And when I took the Holy Quran on the English translation, when I read it, I knew for a fact right there that this book wasn't written by a man. Even though it was an English translation, even though it was English words, I knew for a fact that a man can never come up with these words. And when I got to the verse in the Quran that Allah said, every soul shall taste death, it hit me so hard because everybody around me was dying. Allah says, every soul shall taste death. Every single one of us in this room, we have a date that we're going to die. Every single one of us in this room, we have a grave waiting for us. It doesn't matter your age, we don't know when it's going to happen to us, but every single one of us, we have to die. So when I read that verse in the Quran, it made sense to me because all my friends around me was dying. And I read more verses in the Quran. For example, Allah says in the Quran, He said, truly the hearts find tranquility in the remembrance of Allah. Most people, they think in order to find tranquility, they gotta go get alcohol, they gotta go get high, they gotta go get drunk. This type of stuff is temporary happiness. This is temporary tranquility. It's nothing like practicing the religion of Islam. It's nothing like following the Quran and the Sunnah. It's nothing like going to the circles at the masjid. It's nothing like trying to acquire the Islamic knowledge. It's a feeling that you get in the inside that money, drugs, fame, nothing can make you feel like this way when you're practicing your religion properly. So if you don't got this feeling inside, if you're a Muslim and you feel like you gotta search for something else to get some type of happiness, then obviously you should tell yourself, I'm not on my deen the way I'm supposed to be on my deen. Or you should tell yourself, I'm far away from Allah. If there's any Muslim that's depressed, if there's any Muslim that's looking for some type of happiness, and that's due to the point of you not following your religion. So one of the things that I noticed, the more that I read about this religion, the Quran, like I said, I knew that a man can never come up with these words. I was around people like Tupac. He's a writer. He was, a matter of fact, Tupac was a genius when it comes to writing poems. But the words that Allah was speaking in the Quran, the speech of Allah, because the Quran is the speech of Allah, the words that the Quran was saying, there was no doubt about it that I knew a man could make this up. So I got real inclined to this religion, and eventually I took my shahada. Another thing that drew me close to the religion of Islam is something that the media used to run people away from the religion of Islam. That the Muslims, they oppress their women. This is another thing that, for example, the lifestyle that I come from a neighborhood that if you show kindness towards a woman, it's a form of weakness. If, for example, in Jahiliyyah, when I had female girlfriends, etc., because we know Muslims, we don't have boyfriends and girlfriends. So, of course, this is back in the day. And if some of my friends walk up to me and they see me, I would be ashamed to be holding a female hand, or I'd be ashamed to be talking nicely or calm to a female because it was a sign of weakness. And when I got into the music industry, this was an industry, a billion-dollar industry, multi-billion-dollar industry that pumped billions and millions of dollars into the records and promote music to disrespect women. This is an industry that promotes music to have you disrespect your own mother to sell records. So I got to the point that I thought that this was the normal life. I thought talking bad against a woman, I thought that talking, cursing at a woman, treating a woman with no respect, this is the lifestyle that I truly believe, no doubt about it, that I thought this was a normal thing. I never had an uncle that come to me and said, this is how you should treat the woman. My grandmother never taught me this, so I learned from the streets and I learned from the music industry. When I became a Muslim, it was surprising that when I read the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the way that he treated his wife, the way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba treated their wives, I never even knew men could do this to women. For example, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, those that are best of the Muslim nation, those that are best out of you are those that are best of their wives. And I'm the best of you to my wives. The wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they said, Aisha ready to handle, for example, she said, I used to race with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She used to race with her husband. How many of us now, if our wife asks us to race with her, we think we're too gangster, we're too tough. Look, women, I don't race. I'm the chief of my tribe. I'm the leader of my tribe. We don't do this in my tribe. How many of us would do this? This is Allah's messenger. This is Allah's messenger used to race with his wife. Some of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, for example, they used to drink out of a cup, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would take that cup, turn it around to make sure that he put his mouth on the part that his wife used to drink out of. He was very kind to his wife. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught us, when I read about this, when he said, for example, he said that the woman of Adam, he said Allah created Adam out of mud. And he said, Allah created the woman from the most crookedest bone in the body, which is the ribs. So the Prophet said, if you try to straighten her, you will break her. So just basically let her be. When you read these type of words, when the Prophet in another narration, he referred to the woman as a glass vessel. He referred to the woman as she's so fragile as if she was a glass vessel. When I read this coming from a gangster music industry, when we were taught that the woman is harsh, and we were taught that in order for me to put this woman in my video, she had to be the one that take most of her clothes off, she had to be the one that drink the most alcohol, she had to be the one to leave her husband at home or a boyfriend at home in order to get in the video, this is called oppression to the woman. This is called oppression to the woman, man. The religion of Islam, when I read it, this was the first religion that I seen that actually freed the woman. This is the first religion that I actually read that actually wasn't using a woman to sell car insurance, that wasn't using a woman, that was telling a woman to cover up her beauty. This was amazing to me. So the more that I read about this religion, I knew for a fact this is what I need in my life. So alhamdulillah, I accepted the religion of Islam. Now there might be some non-Muslims in here that might say, okay, we know that the religion of Islam, you say, you're good to your woman. Okay. They might say, well, we see some Muslims that treat their women bad, which might be true, just like you have Jews and Christians that also treat their women bad, but it has nothing to do with their religion. It has to do with the person, the individual, and his character. Just like they might say, okay, your religion say be good to the woman, my religion say the same thing. But what's different from your religion and my religion? Why are you a Muslim? And most Muslims, unfortunately, if you ask most Muslims, why are you a Muslim? They don't even know why they're a Muslim. Unfortunately, if you ask so many kids, why are you a Muslim? They would say, because my mother and father was a Muslim. Like Allah says in the Quran, how many of the people said, I'm on the religion of my forefather. Most people, especially the people that's born into the religion, unfortunately, that come from certain Muslim countries and come to this land, unfortunately, not everybody, I'm not saying everybody, but some of them, they take their religion for granted. They take this religion of Islam for granted. Either they think either they pretend they know that they're going to paradise, or they know they're the chosen ones, or obviously they don't even know the blessings of being a Muslim. They don't even know the blessing that Allah guided you to make you a Muslim. They don't even know, man, if we worship Allah one time, in order to do one prayer to Allah, do you know how much of a mercy that is from Allah that He would even allow us to pray to Him?